Hello, this is the Tradesight Forex Market Preview and International Economic Data Roadmap for the week beginning Sunday, the 3rd of August, 2014, ending Friday, the 8th. Charts, as usual, brought to you by eSignal. Hope you had a great trading week. Here's a look at the dollar index. Finally, something to maybe talk about here. We've been mentioning this week. We've had some winners because the market's starting to move a little bit. And here we are, right at the high of this range we've been in for the last, since October last year, so 10 months, right? Are we about to break out finally and get out of this range? We don't have any counts that would suggest exhaustion, so there's certainly room to move to the upside. And if we do break out of this range, this might be the start of something special for Forex. I remember a couple years ago, Forex got exciting in August. You can actually see that even though we're still in this narrow range, at least July saw some movement, especially the last 2 weeks or so. Which is an improvement and part of the reason we've had several of the winners that we've had in Forex here over the last couple of weeks. A little bit better and bigger winners than we've been seeing over the rest of the summer. So we'll see. We're going to keep an eye on this and obviously see if we can break out from here on the dollar index. And here's a look at the euro dollar. Obviously coming to the downside as the dollar is breaking out. Still in a narrow range. 600 pips for the last year. That's not very strong. Pound obviously breaking down as well, but higher up on the chart in general. We did just break a longer term trend line. So again, a lot of stuff pointing technically to the dollar breaking out. Here's the Aussie dollar, much more narrow, of course. Gonna see some support there at that 9,200. That's a static trend line. We'll take a look at the pound yen, the cross pair. Nothing going here yet. We've had 213 sell signals in the last 8 months on the pound yen. Both of them gave us the high at the time. And now we're nowhere near a count, but be interesting to see what the cross pairs do if the dollar does indeed break out. Here's a quick look at the New Zealand dollar as well. As usual, let's take a look at the intra-week action of the week we just cleared up, finished up, and see what happened. Talk about the total ranges for the week. So the low of the euro here is about 33.70, 1.3370, and the high is about 1.3450. You know what that means? It means the entire week was spent in an 80-pip range. So even though we saw some movement in the dollar, it wasn't really here on this pair. Remember, the euro typically on average over the last 10 years trades about 130 pips per day from high to low. So 80 pips for the entire week remains pretty feeble. But the pound did do a little bit better, and this is where we made some money, and this is nice to see again. And by the way, this isn't that impressive, but it's better. 180 pips of range on the pound for the week. A lot of it to the downside. We were short, and things worked out. So a good way to wrap up the month of July. We will be posting our results for July on our market blog on the Tradesight website here for the weekend, both for Forex and futures. It's been a reasonable month for Forex. Nothing killer yet, but obviously if the market starts moving like we've seen this last week, we could get better results moving forward. Let's take a look at the Aussie dollar. High to low here, about 130 pips. New Zealand dollar, high to low here. About 100 pips, just under, and the pound yen sold off Friday, but still only 160 pips range. Look how flat Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday were on the pound yen. Yikes, not pretty. All right, so what do we have ahead this next week that we can pay attention to? Well, let's look. Obviously, this last week we had a lot of data. We had the first look at GDP for the second quarter here in the U.S. We had a two-day Fed meeting. We had the unemployment rate and some other data. So let's see. This week's not going to be as exciting. What do we have? Monday. I'm sorry. This is still last week. So let's go down and take a look at next week. There we go. August 3rd. Starting on Sunday, Australia on a bank holiday. Japan has their monetary base released. MI inflation gauge out of Australia. Commodity prices out of New Zealand. Retail sales out of Australia. That's all Sunday night going into Monday. Europe has Spanish unemployment and Swiss SVME PMI. Centex investor confidence out of Europe, the UK's construction PMI data, PPI out of Europe. Canada's on a bank holiday all day Monday, as well as Australia. Loan officer survey here in the US, not a big deal. AIG services index, trade balance out of Australia, 10-year bond auction out of Japan. We got the cash rate in Australia, that's their Bank of Australia and rate announcement, like our Fed essentially on Tuesday. Europe's various services PMI data, including the UK, Italy, Spain, and the broad European number, retail sales out of Europe. First real data out of the US is on Tuesday, the final services PMI, the non-manufacturing ISM number, factory orders, TIP, IBD, economic optimism number. Then all the way skip ahead to the night here in the US, New Zealand's employment change, unemployment rate, labor cost index data. Wednesday in the wee hours of the morning, Japan's leading indicators, German factory orders, CPI out of Switzerland, Europe's Italian industrial production, retail PMI data, manufacturing production, and industrial production out of the UK. We've got trade balance. That's one of our big three each month. Big three numbers. It's one of the three. Wednesday morning here in the US at 8:30. So we'll be less than half size. You lower your size ahead of the big numbers that can spike the market. It's too high risk. Ahead of that number. GDP estimate out of the UK, crude oil inventories here in the US, Australia's got their unemployment data and their AIG construction index. We go to Thursday, German industrial production, French trade balance, foreign currency reserves out of Switzerland, Spanish 10-year bond auction, UK, the Bank of England's rate announcement, ECB, the Broad Europe Bank announced rate announcement. That's a big set of data right there. Probably flat until that comes out, just like we're flat ahead of the Fed typically. Canada's building permits and IV PMI data. US has their natty gas and then consumer credit in the afternoon. Going into Friday, so Thursday evening here in the US, Japan's current account and bank lending, the Australia's home loans and monetary policy statement from the announcement earlier in the week, Japan's monetary policy statement as well, China's trade balance number, Japan's economy watcher sentiment, unemployment rate out of Switzerland, German trade balance, Bank of Japan press conference for their rate announcement, Europe's French industrial production, trade balance out of the UK, that's a big number, that's at 4:30 a.m. Eastern time on Friday, construction output, unemployment rate out of Canada, preliminary non-farm productivity and unit labor costs for here in the U.S., followed by wholesale inventories, and then for whatever reason, Friday night at 9:30 p.m., CPI and PPI out of China, way to release the data away from the market. So that's it. So the trade balance is the big one, obviously, but there are some rate announcements, key ones, Australia, UK, Europe. The UK and Europe are Thursday morning. So be aware of all that. I'll try to make some trade calls for you. I'll be helping you out in the lab. Hope to see you there. As usual, if you need to take a trial of our services, they are available. Have a great trading week.